democracy. As an enemy sabotage weapon, here is the effect which it could have on a city, according to Dr. Sidney Cohen, chief psychosomatic officer of medicine at the Los Angeles Veterans Hospital. He describes it in his book entitled The Beyond Within and writes, quote, "The city exposed to a successful LSD attack presumably will cease to function. The inhabitants will be so bemused with the odd things that are happening to them and their neighbors that for half a day an aggressor force could take over without substantial resistance. A saboteur could carry enough in an overcoat pocket to produce serious temporary effects on all of the inhabitants of a megalopolis such as Los Angeles or New York, if only he could distribute it evenly. The contents of a two-suiter piece of luggage will hold amounts sufficient to disable every person in the United States." Unquote. The ease with which this brain-muddling chemical could be delivered to a whole population is contained in a recent report from Los Angeles, which says, quote, "Not only could it be distributed through the water supply, but it may be suspended in the air, and the inhalation is equally effective as a casualty producer." Unquote. At the present time, however, America's chemical warfare attack is not by enemies from abroad, but by enemies within. The Los Angeles Police Department reports that interviews with several thousand drug users clearly demonstrates that both young people and adults tend to follow a definite pattern of evolution as they commence with routine thrill pills and then progress gradually into heavy addiction with opiate narcotics. The Los Angeles report indicates that after individuals have more or less fooled around with the abuse of medical drugs, they tend to develop a curiosity to experiment with something a little more daring. Once again, it is not a professional pusher who usually gets a person to try something new, but the closest associates and friends. This next step is nearly always in the direction of the hallucination drugs. The most popular ones at the moment are LSD and marijuana. We have already discussed the effects of the more powerful LSD, so let us look briefly at marijuana. Marijuana is one of the oldest psychedelic plants in the world. It originated in China, but was later cultivated in India and became known as Indian hemp. The plant has a male and female species. The narcotic resin is particularly abundant in the female plant. Marijuana is processed by taking the flowering tops and leaves of both the male and female plants and then drying them by indirect heat. After the seeds and stems are removed, the dry fibers tend to crumble and resemble catnip or tea, hence the nickname for marijuana. Although there are several ways of using marijuana, the most popular method in the United States is smoking it. The marijuana cigarette is shorter and thinner than the commercial variety, and the ends are crimped and tucked in to prevent the contents from spilling out. Because these cigarettes pass through many hands as they are sold and traded back and forth, they are usually wrapped in double tissues of white or brown cigarette paper so as to stand the wear and tear. The effect produced by marijuana is that of excitement, sometimes hallucinations. However, increased indulgence will produce drowsiness and unconsciousness, so it is technically classified as a sedative. The pupil of the eye of the marijuana smoker becomes extremely dilated, and the white portion of the eye becomes bloodshot. In this condition, the pupil of the eye will not react normally to light, and the user will squint or completely close his eyes as though he were looking at the headlights of an approaching car. This is why the marijuana smoker often resorts to dark glasses and wears them even at night. This does not suggest, however, that everybody who happens to be wearing dark glasses is suffering from the toxic effect of marijuana. As with LSD, marijuana impairs time and depth perception. A curb may look like a deep canyon or cliff, but when the user is standing on a real cliff, he will swear that the bottom of the canyon is only a step away. Marijuana also destroys the normal inhibitions of the user, resulting in sexual promiscuity or criminal acts of violence. This has been cited as one of the reasons why so many of the most vicious sex crimes are perpetrated by marijuana users. Crimes of robbery, burglary, and homicide are also common in these cases, and the police found that individuals are usually under the influence of marijuana when a person tries his first injection of heroin. Marijuana exaggerates whatever mood a person may be in. It gives him a delusion of greatness, strength, and influence. He conceives of himself as a talented artist or an enchanting lover. He may also appear to be content or easygoing, even hysterically laughing, but he can immediately fly into a violent rage at the slightest provocation. Because of this unpredictable effect of behavior, police officers consider a person under the influence of marijuana to be dangerous. Continuous use of this drug will deteriorate the brain tissues, bring about a complete state of insanity in some cases, which requires permanent confinement to a mental institution. Here are the more obvious and readily apparent symptoms of a person under the influence of marijuana. First, visible muscular tremors. Second, accelerated pulse and heartbeat. Third, reckless and erratic operation of an automobile. Four, dizziness resulting in an irregular walk and an unsteady stride. Five, irrational behavior such as reckless and brazen disregard toward other people. Now, the Los Angeles police report indicates that when a youth or adult has become somewhat accustomed to experimenting with LSD and marijuana, there is a very likely possibility that he will try the heavy opiates. This brings him to a disastrous crisis of total drug addiction. Here is the way an 18-year-old boy named Jan from New York City evolved into heavy narcotics. He says, quote, "This will sound crazy, but after LSD, I felt I didn't exist anymore. I was nothing. I shouldn't be alive. I had no feeling of who I was. That so depressed me, I started on junk, heroin. Then I didn't feel anything," unquote. Jan became a hardened addict and soon found that he was committing serious crimes to get the money for his craving of narcotics. Heroin is probably the worst of all the alkaloids that can be manufactured from opium. It is completely impractical for medical purposes. Its manufacture has been outlawed. Heroin has all the bad features of other addictive drugs, plus the fact that it is many times stronger. It is also extremely expensive. Heroin addicts frequently reach the stage where $50 to $75 per day are required to get enough heroin just to feel normal. The cells of the body not only crave the narcotic to feed upon, but they threaten to go into convulsions if the narcotic is delayed or withheld. This is called the withdrawal symptoms, which absolutely terrifies the drug addict. It is this fear of withdrawal, as much as the craving for the drug, which drives an addict to commit crimes and get the money needed to buy more dope. Here is what withdrawal is like. As the body cells begin signaling for a fix, the addict commences yawning, accompanied by profuse sweating and running of the nose and eyes. There is marked dilation of the pupils of the eye, and severe hot flashes begin surging through the system, followed by an attack of cold chills. The muscles begin to twitch. This is a sign that the system is getting ready to go into withdrawal pains. It is this stage which terrifies the addict. The whole body commences to go into violent cramps. Addicts describe the excruciating pain as shooting from the roots of their hair down to their toenails. There is continuous nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Life becomes a torturous nightmare and sleep is impossible. Addicts have been known to remain awake for weeks at a time, resting only in a coma. The pain is so severe during the first several days of withdrawal that the addict will throw himself to the floor, double up in convulsive cramps, and scream for relief. Unless one has seen a confirmed addict pass through this torturous experience, it is almost impossible to comprehend. One would imagine that this would permanently cure a person who has been subject to addiction. Unfortunately, it does not. The vast majority of those who have once been hooked on anything as strong as heroin will go back to it eventually, even after they are supposed to be cured. This is the real tragedy of the so-called hippies and the 13 to 15-year-old teeny boppers. They think they are just enjoying a temporary binge of drugs, sex, and psychedelic hallucinations, when they are actually launching into a pattern which, if continued, is guaranteed to turn them from healthy and wholesome human beings into half-mad creatures of a nightmare existence. When I see some of these young people in the prime of life with their straggly hair, dirty clothes, and sleazy gait, herding together like a cult of uncivilized cave dwellers, I cannot help but wonder what will happen to them further down the trail.